So, thank you. I'm in the same place that I defended my PhD and with my advisor there. So, we have this week some roundtable about the future of particle physics. So, Sasha invited me. So, I thought nothing more close than the talk about Higgs potential, and that also connects with my PhD that I did here, and also with the plans for next colliders. So when you talk about Higgs potential, we can talk also about double Higgs production at the LHC, because it's one of the first methods that we are going to have a direct assessment to the Higgs trilinear coupling. And moreover, as this is the last piece of electroweak symmetry breaking to be measured at some point, if there is some, I believe, if there is some BSM, it's very likely going to appear in the double Higgs. So in here, CMS and Atlas, when we try to use this parametrization of anomalous couplings to put there everything that we may not know about the Higgs potential. So what Atlas and CMS are doing about it, and here we have a table of a colored table about what Higgs decay to in which probability, and we put on numbers only the probabilities that we have public results by now. Most of them are the ones that have one BB bar to help to tag stuff, but these more rare final states, they are starting to be explored. One thing is that, as you see, we have a rich phenomenology to exploit many final states. Different branching ratios, so we can also exploit these when you do a Kappa scan or something like this. Usually, everything that has a BB have common techniques of analysis, and so inside experiments, you have actually everybody working together in these common stuff. And you're going to see in the end that according to the kinematic distributions, the final states can have similar or not sensitivities. So what I'm going to do here is present the analysis, discuss the interpretations and the plans for future, and then we continue on Wednesday in that. The first one I present is the 4B final state. This is a very nice, it should be a very nice one, because you can actually reconstruct everything that all the final states and try to reconstruct the double Higgs itself. But it happens that it have a very big multi-jet background. How it tag events in 4Bs? There was some trigger development of a combination of multi-jet VTAG triggers that are developed especially to 4B, because people like it. And you also need to use machine learning a lot if you want to reconstruct all that. So, but even though as QCD is not much reliable in Monte Carlo, all the methods for background estimates, both in Atlas, in CMS and Atlas, for the non-resonant stuff, are data-driven. Atlas have a bit more pixels and a bit more information in the BTAG itself, so it can have an anti-BTAG region and do this data-driven more naturally, what is usually done. CMS, for the first study, did this what is called hemisphere mixing, that instead of have a control region in the signal region itself, he took that event, cut in the middle, and reconfigure, and do the background information for these.
Can you explain that better? So they take the whole data of 4Bs, and then they mix
then the data? You assume that KCD is two jets back-to-back. And then you find the crest axis of these two jets back-to-back, cut in the middle, and then you join the hemispheres.
So two jets, but they have four jets, right, in the signal region.
Yeah, but you assume that KCD is the background. You assume that it's two jets. And then you cut in the middle. Because you are trying to model the background, not the signal. And the signal, as it's very small, you don't care if you have a little bit of four jets events there, because you have this, you see here in CMS, it's a huge background, small signal.
So when you say background is back-to-back, is because so you have the main event is back-to-back, but then you have some soft radiation that can give you extra jets or something like that?
Yeah, I'm not saying that it's back-to-back itself, but the at leading order, the assumption is that it's back-to-back. And then you have all the radiation that is going to do the four jets, yes.
And how do you tag?
In the four jets, yes. And in the mass of the two Higgses. But if you're reconstructing jets, this is a bit more broader than it should. Then you have all this machine learning stuff there.
Maybe a drawing can help.
Yeah. So you take a data event, you assume that it's back-to-back, and then you have all the radiation. You assume you have the two main jets back-to-back and have the radiation. So you find what is the crest axis here, and cut this event in two. And then you have part one, part two. In the second event, you're going to have one, two, and you mix together. You say that this is, you mix with 3D these two things. And then your background,
you take another event.
You take another event. Yeah, you're mixing from different events, different hemispheres. Because you cannot believe in Monte Carlo, and CMS didn't have a very good control region for triggers. So this was the way of doing data-driven. Now we're exploring more. It's like you take two oranges, cut in half, and put them together. And this is the background that appears here. This is the blue. And then you have the agreement with data that is very good. So it was an interesting technique. I worked in this one particularly. But if one of the main problems was to deal with the bias that you have when you're mixing the first level of event with the second. But then you have some statistics there, and everything closes down. But anyhow, I think we can pass to the next one. That is BB Total. This one was very surprising to be a very nice result. Was not expecting it to be better than, let's say, gamma-gamma, but reconstruction of taus in both CMS and Atlas is advanced very much with new techniques and new triggers techniques also for directly for taus. The problem with that is that you have incomplete final state, neutrinos. Then, but you know what you want to reconstruct, so you can try to reconstruct what the neutrinos are going to be, and to in order to have AGH, and to work with that, or with MVA, or with kinematics itself analytically. These ones that are public, we are working on always when you have one hadronic tau. So two hadronic taus have the most branching ratio, but also the most background. And then you have the trade-offs when you have a muon electron. As I said, there is this M tau tau that is estimated by the neutrinos with some magic kinematics relations. Well, most of the background is mostly Drillian. You have also TT bar and fake taus. Fake taus, they always need to more or less have to be taken from data in some contour regions. Here is the contrary. Atlas fit BDT and CMS uses a variable that is MT2 that was done for SUSY searches that you try to reconstruct the math with the neutrinos. Then you continue. One of the lowest sensitivity ones that you have up to now is BBWW. Mostly because BBWW, you think is TT bar. So you have this large irreducible TT bar. Then you have no escape, but then use machine learning. That is no other way. So both Atlas and CMS use a DNN, a deep neural network, to try to separate stuff, and but using different way. Atlas do this DNN, but at some point it does cut and count in some cut that it does. And CMS fits the whole spectrum. And you have the TT bar that dominates very much what is background. It can be done from Monte Carlo. This is the only good thing from this channel and the separation of the double Higgs. One thing that CMS didn't lose is to use a parameterized deep neural net in different values of the Higgs of coupling. Why? Because kinematics change, and we are going to see about that. And then we arrive to BB gamma gamma. That was also on my PhD thesis here, but not this result, because those are the latest results from Atlas and CMS. That we have very rare, because you have gamma-gamma, but you have a good gamma-gamma resolution if you try to reconstruct the peak there. And on top of that, what the two experiments do is to try to categorize events to have more and less poor categories and the fit to be better in the end. Atlas categorizes events in BTAG. CMS, because of it was a bit more aware of these changes in kinematics with the Higgs for Niña, also categorizing mass of the two Higgses to improve this this sensitivity. And instead of categorizing BTAG, it does an MVA, and categorizing, you put it in the MVA, it doesn't cut or it doesn't fit. But both look for MHH. Then, from then enough with BB, we start to try to populate the rest of that table of Higgs decays with more rarer channels. By now, only Atlas have it out, but CMS is also keeping up. We have WW gamma gamma. Always when you have a gamma-gamma, you see that. And you have four Ws that it should be multi-lepton because everything goes together for Ws, for disease, TT, for Ts. And you have categorizations, some vetoes in BJET because in here you can enjoy from that. And by now, it's a counting experiment in cut-based categories. These are the combined results in standard model. The latest one, run one is still. Even if there are some results going out with run two, it's not everything there. So in combination, it's only run one. In Atlas, you see there is a ladder. The nicest channel is BB total. And then there is for B, because they have the super trigger and tracker in the middle. And then BB gamma gamma. And CMS, BB gamma gamma starts to be better. Then you have total, and then you have BB. And then the more rare stuff with vector bosons. But one thing you can see is that the combination always takes advantage of all the channels. It's not that the best channel is leading all the combination. And with the RAN2 now, 2018 data, we are going to have four times this data set. So we expect to improve in the standard model.
So sorry, can you go back? Mm-hmm. So the bottom line is that so Atlas has a sensitivity of less than 10 times the standard model combining everything? Is that?
Yes.
Why is CMS so much worse?
In BBBA is the data-driven techniques and the lack of B-type trigger that you can do data-driven with less statistics uncertainties. BB total, if you don't tell anybody, it's politics. There was a very much better result, but it was done for a group that was not so preeminent, so it's politics. And BB gamma gamma, I don't know, it's more or less 20. Yeah, this is much better in BB gamma gamma as well. Yes, 29, 27 to 29, and 39 in West Picobanis. Ours, 2017 data.
So how much data, just remind me, how much data you have on tape?
Four times more.
Four times more.
Mm-hmm.
So there's still some work.
Yeah, a lot. But then it comes the problem. This is a standard model.
What does it mean that you observe 22 times standard model, but the expected was 12? What does that mean, that you're not observing what was expected? So why is that?
Because you have a lot of data fluctuation. And BB gamma gamma here, you can see you have fluctuation. You cannot expect the same that you observe.
This is like if you go back.
Then everything is on the error bands.
So the error bars are large.
Everything needs to be encoded because you don't have much data.
So the difference between observed and expected, how many standard deviations?
And here, two.
Two?
Yeah. One is up and one is down.
Okay, so it's not like nothing to be worried about.
Oh, we are going to have more data. No, one is up and one is down in the fluctuation. So it's not a 750
GV.
The idea is to have, once the run tool is fully analyzed, because these things give work, you need to know what overlaps with what, and it's a lot of work to do the combination. There was a pre-combination of it, but I don't remember if it became public.
I think I saw some results with more luminosity.
Yeah, but it's not in the combination because we don't have all the results with the full luminosity. That is only BBWW, and it's one of the worst. So okay. Don't want to do combination with that.
Do you have an expectation of what is the level of measurements that they're going to obtain after the full run two? It's like
No, I have on here the end of the Hailumia Legacy.
Okay.
But not expectation of run two because we are doing the results, so it doesn't make sense to do expectation. It's going to be there soon.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So the complication with that is that if that was talking about a standard model topology, and even if you try to variate only the Higgs Rodinia, if you remember.
I have one question about standard model before you go to beyond standard model. The theoretical cross section, is this computed at what level? Next to
the two n's.
Two n's. So it's not, because the
and
the lowest order is already a box diagram.
And the Monte Carlo is 1n.
The Monte Carlo?
To a standard model.
Thank you.
Then we have beyond a standard model, where only if you see kappa lambda, you see the box and diagram, the box and triangle diagram, they interfere a lot, mostly here in the threshold. So you can have, if you have only the triangle, that is a lot of K lambda, very very high. You have this threshold effect, and at some point, you can have, if you have some nice trade off, you can have double peaks. Or a more boosted like events. This is a bit challenging to take into account in the analysis. I told about two ways that CMS try to do this. If a user's MVA try to do a parametric in kappa lambda, if it uses a cut base, I try to, for example, to make a categorization here to see that you have the best sensitivities of the two worlds. One idea of how the limits change if this topology change, it's in this combined results in kappa lambda variation from Atlas and CMS. You see that you have this strange shape, this that is all kinematics that is there. And so one thing, you cannot take the results of standard model and put in terms of kappa lambda. You need to do these scans. And these are the results from Atlas and CMS. You see, CMS, Atlas is a bit better, but it's in the same ballpark if you take about kappa lambda. But you don't have only the trilinear, as I told. We have other couplings there. And for example, here it's a cross-section enhancement that you have with respect with standard model. If you have kappa lambda and Tobiukawa, or DC2 here is a top Higgs-Higgs contact interaction. And contact interactions also with gluons. One thing you see in blue, you have a more or less a factor 100 increment in cross-section. So you need to take that into account. But you remember that there is also the kinematics. And as you know how this cross-section variates there, you can infer that the variations of kinematics are also going to be huge. And
you can exclude the region where kappa t is lower than 1?
Lower than 1, I don't think we can exclude yet.
But why?
We are here.
Your exclusion is lower than 1, so it means that you're...
But the kinematics is different. So, and if you see here, the exclusion gets higher. The exclusion is better in the standard model, but it gets a bit worse in the high kappa t regime, and this all in the low kappa T or high kappa lambda. The limits get lower.
This is
just the cross section. And the idea was to try to have a first parameterization of if we can have an idea of how the shapes behave in these scans of parameters. That, one idea that I have with people in Padova that is being used now as a guidance for the analysis itself is to assume that at least in order that Higgs is back-to-back, it's completely back-to-back, it's the same history there, but you don't have radiation at all. So you can reconstruct everything if you have the cos theta star and the MHH. So we have two distributions only. So what we did was to take into account this two distribution, this 2D distribution, bin, and with this bin distributions construct a statistical measure where you can say, well, these two samples are close, these are not close, and those are closer than to, the other two. And with this and a lot and Monte Carlo, a large scan in Monte Carlo in this leading order space, we can use this statistical measure and only based on that to separate the typical shapes that you have from the Bohr-Higgs in different like shape benchmarks, how we call. And here I show how they differ. One thing important to notice is that for every shape benchmark that is in red, you have this spread of blue shapes. That is like it's not that it's one to one, but you can say that you have something that is similar to the red, is similar enough that you're going to have a similar limit to it.
Mm-hmm. A couple of questions. So you're using leading order Monte Carlo simulations. How well can you trust leading order in this case?
In the backup, there is a comparison with next leading order. And if you take into account the normalized distributions, you can trust very well. And to the limits,
the
what
shapes,
matters?
It's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
And also, so what's the difference between the benchmark scenarios? Just to have an idea. You're just changing the kappas, or?
You're just changing. Oh, so to have an idea, you see here how they look like in the these different points in Topiokawa kappa lambda, Topiokawa TT Higgs. You see that you're changing the kappas.
So just changing the kappas can change the shape dramatically?
Like this, yes.
Wow.
And that's the whole problem of doing EFT with the Higgs, or doing EFT with almost everything that you have interferences.
So that's from interference.
Yes. And one nice trade-off of this is that although these have nothing of physics separating the shapes, there is a connection with physics. If you try and look in this parameter space of the carpet itself, you see that the different shapes are the different signals are different benchmarks, and then kind of enclosed regions of fully connected regions. And this is what we would expect, more or less. There is a code here. What is triangle down is threshold. What is triangle up, it's something that is boosted. A ball, something in the middle. And the cross is everything that has two bumps. Usually, these crosses, they go together with where you have the most of the cross-section changes. And so how to use this? Because this is not it's not that you're going to take a point here, and if you see the limit for benchmark 12, it's going to be the very number. No, this is to have an idea of how the analysis is sensitive to differentiation of the shape, and to have an idea of the impact of it, of trying to do something more shape it to that check benchmark or not. And here we have from CMS the results in the shape benchmarks that I showed to you. And one thing you can see that is that this is BBVV, BB tau tau for Bs, BB gamma gamma, and you have the combined. If you go from the combined, you still can have more than one order of magnitude of different in limits. So it's not so easy to translate limits to couplings. And you can see also that these different types of green, they behave differently with the different shapes. For example, BBV gamma gamma is not so good with threshold, while 4Bs is better with BBV gamma gamma is good with threshold, and 4Bs is not so good with threshold because you have you need to trigger in jets, and then the triggers cannot go so low in energy. So this is nice information inside the experiments to try to design analysis, kind of. But when you give results in terms of shape benchmarks, you can still have some information in the theory point of view, some information from the fact that those clusters shape benchmarks, they was constructed based in a distance between a statistical difference between shapes. So if you have a weird shape, doesn't matter if it's kappa, if something with the loop, or it only matters that it's HH. You can enter to some box and say, what is the shape benchmark that I have that is most similar to the shape? So most likely, your limit is going to be the one that is similar to the shape. And you can use this to infer what you have in your favorite model. For example, here, I took a Tokyo-Kawa kappa lambda scan. One analysis that was recastable because that was the 2016 analysis. This was quite based, so you can do outside the experiment a very nice recast. And then I compare what happens with the blank recast and this approximation with the shape benchmarks. The result that is this comparison of the continuous with the dashed, they seem a pretty fair assessment if you want to have an idea what your limits is going to be. In this, I didn't do kind of comparison ratios or anything. I just wanted to see that the limit itself at the level of Higgs would look like. And if you take a leap of faith and try to use the latest results from CMS in terms of benchmarks and try to use these maps of benchmarks maps in kappa, in the kappa scan, you can see how the limits can behave. And you can see, for example, if you have some very drastic change of shape, so you can have interesting features on the boundaries and what is allowed. The observed, you see here, there is a feature here that it would be nicer to assess with actually a full scan, a full recast. but you can have an idea of what is happening without having to wait for it.
What are these numbers?
The numbers are the closest shape benchmarks. So you take a point here, and then you do these test statistics with all the shape benchmarks. The closest one for this point was the 4.
So the 4 benchmark.
Yeah, shape benchmark. Doesn't say that it's the shape, but it does look like. And as I have this since 3 years, 12 is something that is very threshold-like. 4 is a standard model-like that you have a bubble in 400 GV in MHH. That's why this difference in limits, and that's why this strange feature.
Right. So the blue shaded areas are excluded?
Inferred to be excluded. Oh, because you cannot say that the limit from the shape benchmark is the one that is going to be here, but it's very similar. So it's where you expect to have the exclusion. Because one thing that is very difficult to do in the experiment is to do these scans in very large, in different planes. So I cannot say that is excluded for sure. But this is where how it would look like.
I'm sorry. I mean, say take for example benchmark 4.
Mm-hmm.
If you're in the blue area, is it excluded or not?
It's excluded. In this approximation, that you have the limit from the shape benchmark being the limit of the cluster itself. That is 10%, 10%-ish.
Okay,
so it's excluded with a 10%-ish in the boundaries.
And now if I take 2 for the same value, is it excluded or not?
Here? This region is not excluded.
Okay.
Because it's a combination of the cross-section and the shape. It's for. Yeah.
But what's the minimum value of kappa t you considered for 0.5? Have you considered 0 for kappa t?
You cannot, otherwise, you some things numerically doesn't go, but 0, it's here. It's more or less.
No, I mean kappa t.
Ah, no, because you have kappa T, you have TTH.
I know, I just want to compare to another model that you have instead of you have something else that has only the mix to these others.
I never arrived at that, but you can easily arrive there.
There is 0.5 for kappa.
Mm-hmm. But once you have that 2 that you cannot, each kappa that you have, and arrive to the closest shape benchmark, you can do it yourself and arrive down. It's not easy. It's not difficult. And because it's not difficult, it's not so much accepted. What you can do.
Mm-hmm. Let me just go back. I was saying that the idea is to make possible to estimate the effect of the experimental results in our favorite model. So I have a favorite model.
Mm-hmm. And then you can map to the kappas.
Come up to the kappas and then to the benchmarks.
Mm-hmm.
And then I look at this plot and see where my model is, if it's excluded or not.
No, I would say that it's more like this. You have your favorite model. For instance, this is to Higgs doublet model with some symmetry, some Z6 symmetry. And then you do this mapping. And then here I'm overlaying the mapping of the shape benchmarks that are the numbers with the acceptance of the 2016 analysis. You can see there is a clear correlation between them. So the idea is that you take your favorite model, translate in kappas, and then you can do these kind of maps and see where are the limits.
So let me ask a question. Maybe I didn't understand correctly, but when you show the distribution that you look to see to put bounds, those distributions, they come from some neural net ions are from the invariant mass of the HH system. And they're different things, right? So how can you use the HH invariant mass if you're not for these things, if you're not using that for the real analysis?
Because if you have HH leading others back-to-back, and then if you have MHH and cos theta psi that is mostly flat, you have out the topology.
So there's a way to map the MHH to the neural network analysis somehow?
That is this test statistics measure of what is the closest shape that you have. Uh-huh. And then
so
you do this by
MHH.
Yeah. You assume that the NLO effects are going to be more or less the same in
other.
But the idea is that if you have other stuff in the loop there, and you only have HH, you still can do everything with reconstruct everything with MHH and cos theta star. So you can use the same measure to find your closer shape benchmark.
But then your benchmarks will not
fit correctly. No, they work. You find the closest shape, and then that's it. It doesn't matter what is inside the loop or what is inside, or doesn't matter what is the kappa. You see, you have. If you have very strong radiation, it doesn't work if you have a
heart. You cannot use EFT.
Yeah.
So it's probably just the top loop plus the
mm-hmm. What already covers a bit of stuff. Yeah. So that was the idea, but also even if you stay in EFT, you have some beyond stuff to look in HH. The second largest cross section is from VBF, and VBF you have the same history. You have Lagrangian with couplings, and then if you look at the distributions itself, they change with couplings a little less violently than gluon fusion, but one nice thing is that you have is the first time that you can assess this contact interaction between the vector bosons and two Higgses. One thing is the cross sections are lower than the standard model one, but in some realistic models, it can become a big portion of the Di-Higgs events. So for example, in here, we variate CV as the minimal composite Higgs model would relate stuff. And this is the ratio of cross-section from BBF and cross-section from gluon fusion in this self-contained model. And it can arrive to 20% of the signal being BBF. So we need to consider it. This is one example of recast. When you have the CV and C2V, and how you can have the correlations between the different, for example, for different kappa lambdas, and the correlation between the three, and actually the in the coupling scan. Same story, it's not easy to try to put this together with gluon fusion. So what Atlas did at the moment is to look at the VBF when you consider that gluon fusion stays standard model one, and you only variate the C2V, that is the different coupling. You see that there is a different behavior that in C2V standard model is where you have the largest limit, the worst limit. But you still have some exclusion in the C2V itself. But I don't know what happens with the self-coupling yet, experimentally. We never do. It's going to arrive. But if you are interested in the self-coupling, there are other ways to take the self-coupling. That is trying to look at electroweak corrections in single Higgs production. And here, CTTH, and here, VBF, VH. I don't remember if you have some in glowing fusion, but I would believe so. But here, you see the cross sections, how they vary if you vary the trilinear coupling. Most of the variation is in TTH, so it's there that you try to have the assessment of the trilinear together with double Higgs. The drawback of this is there is a little bit more model-dependent results. You have loops and electric corrections. You shouldn't expect this to be so broad. And for sure, you have some impact in the shapes itself as well, differential. So Atlas did first this game of combining experimentally Higgs and double Higgs. It was done some before that, some projections by some theorists, and then this is more or less the recipe that was followed for Atlas. Here you have kappa lambda when you fix all of the kappas, and this you see that when you combine double Higgs and single Higgs, you have an improvement in the constraint itself. When you try to float another kappas, for example, all the others, when you fix kappa t and kappa lambda, you have a loss of 5 to 15% of precision, but it's a little bit more model independent. And then you go and finish with future prospects. Future prospects, people are looking only at kappa lambda because it's too complicated to look to much more than that. And also, if we are looking to the future, we expect that we didn't found anything and everything is going to be standard model-like. And so there is no point in looking at something else. Here is a combination of ICMS and Atlas in the prospects. You see in these dashed lines the different final states, and in black the combination. This is 3-atoban, the full ILUMI. In the black, you can arrive to exclude the case where you have no kappa lambda, the degenerated case. But this you can only do when you have all the channels combined. So it's really an effort of a lot of people because there are some different analysis groups in every analysis, every object, and everything. So this comes to...
This is only HH
to be model independent. To put everything together, we are starting now to put. So the only experimental result with VBF is the one in C2V and from Atlas.
So you don't expect VBF to be competitive with the glow fusion?
I expect to help because as we saw, it can arrive to 20% of the signal. The complication is how to do all these things together. What do you assume for C2V when you are variating kappa T and TT Higgs and something like this? But in the standard model itself, it's not a big portion of the cross section. It's less than, it's very big, very small portion of the cross section. People are considering because then you can have high purity regions taking the VBF jets and everything. And I don't know what's going to happen. So that arrived to my conclusions.
The best channel is Vibhika Madhama.
It depends. No, it's Vibhita Uttala in Atlas.
No, but in projection is Vibhika
Madhama. Ah, yes. Because you have much more data, so you can have that AJ, that gamma-gamma peak very nicely. It's the same history of single Higgs itself. It goes increasingly. But you need all the channels. So that's my conclusion. And we're trying to go to the last piece of electroweak symmetry break in the last thing we can measure. The plan is to try to determine this discoupling, or at least 50% confidence level in it before 20 years, because that was the Autobahn. And with the shapes and all the studies, try to discover anomalous couplings as soon as possible, if there are anomalous couplings. And most of all the programs of the new accelerators, they always have in the physics program at least a small part of HH, so it should be of Higgs potential that passed by HH is the only direct way. So that's it. You always have a one hadronic tau, at least on this analysis, because you have more branching ratio to it. And the reconstruction of taus is becoming very, very nice in both experiments. Because you have some handles of it in time of flight and leptons inside. You have more. Mu tau, tau hadronic, E tau hadronic, and 2 tau hadronics. And you categorize on that. And you gain in the scene. Mm-hmm. I would say that. It makes sense that it's a mu tau hadronic because mu's are very well measured. Yeah. In the tweak, they have separated. My guess is that it's the mu tau. My guess, but we need to see that. A tau is tau hadronic, otherwise it. We are trying to expand the fingers to get manpower to do it because you need to have a strong motivation. In here, you have the Higgs potential and the students come. And you have other Higgses.
But other Higgses, this also.
Yeah, the resonant production.
Yeah, there is the resonant production. There is a drawback of all those analyses. But I think you're thinking about the decays to different masses, to 125.
I'm thinking, I have in mind one specific model where you have a decay into two new light scales of
light.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not 125, but they
may be
100 or 200.
It's a completely different analysis. And,
I know.
I knew it was not on the topic. There is some effort to have a 125 and two scanning the light Higgs mass.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't know how it's going. So I don't. It should. Be, but I don't know how this thing is going. It was one postdoc on that. So.
My impression is that they are using the analysis, the fact that the Higgs is 125, in order to select
yes.
the variant mass of the blue bar or whatever, no?
Oh.
So that's my impression, that this is used. So the assumption is that what you were observing is the usual kind of.
Yes, but the question how it's done, because you can. How precise.
Right.
In BB gamma gamma, very precisely. No. Also in 4B, in BB total, maybe you have some leverage, but then you have all the MVAs that take into account the masses, so and yes. this leverage goes
masses
away. Yes, it should be 125 too.
Why you can say differentials, say BB gamma gamma, but we have to expect that there is factorization.
They combine, yeah.
They always combine.
There are also some dedicated search for these two outs, like slight speed, and then the outs go to fermions. Well, which fermion? That's what I want to do. These ones, yeah, Tau mu and.
And there was even an tension in data some couple of years ago.
Yeah,
yeah but it went away, so don't bother. You, to light, guys, it's always good to look to leptons.
What?
To leptons, because you can have a low threshold triggers.
It would be nice to think of topics we can talk to Alexandra also later during coffee. For instance, a question I have is how firm is the theoretical background to all of this? Meaning, you're using the Kappa framework, right?
We are planning to use the Kappa framework, but then you have too much parameters.
Well, you're using
then.
The Kappa framework right now, no? That's what I understood.
Yes, Kappa but then.
And then, you know, what is the theoretical uncertainties in this, and in the sense that, you know, if you use another representation, there's, you know, things like, and also the fact that you're using next leading order EFT,
yes.
and then questions like Diogo asked about, you know, new states and loops and things like that.
Yeah, that's also one thing I wanted to address. The first, I think it was in the first slide, the Lagrange that you showed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot do correction.
So why not?
No, it's use that basis.
It's non-normalizable.
No, that basis is only to have the typical shapes. And then I didn't show it to you, but the typical shapes at next leading order.
If you use directly the EFT parameterization, it's much more robust
directly.
Because it wouldn't matter. We only want shapes. Yeah.
You mean the problem? Polish basis?
For this Kant itself, we use the Kappa because it's the most settled one if you go follow the Higgs cross-section working group. If you go to Vershaw basis or SMEFT or everything else, it's kind of a fight, so it's better not to go there before you decide.
Maybe you know this, but I don't know much. So the theory is non-normalizable because we have higher dimension operators. So when you go one loop, what do you mean by going one loop? You really?
No, but in that, the EFT is non-normalizable order by order. You just have
yes.
to add the.
So people do that. You add the, you compute the extra term, and then.
You have to add all the other, the higher dimension operators to normalize it.
So you go to dimension 8?
But in order to go to.
Yes.
But the dimension 6 is the first order EFT. Sorry, no, zero. It didn't order EFT, right? So to go to the mesh array.
And the idea was to try to decouple all these thing of bases.
Yeah. So my whole question is how well, this is something I'd like to discuss. I don't know.
Yeah, for that you need to go to dimension 8. For that, because you need to do two loops, right? Oh, since it's not diverging, the leading order is at one loop. You don't need. I think you can probably renormalize with the dimension 6.
There is some dimension 8, but then you can assume, there are some people that calculated that the impact of dimension 8 is very small in the cross-section itself. But
I don't know. I think this is something I would be interested to discuss. I really don't know. The other thing I really don't know is this. I was thinking about this when she showed the DDI confusion to Big 6. Because there, if you think naivety and use the equivalence theorem, it seems that they're kind of probing for the four-point coupling. Right? So it's not only the triple vertex. It seems that they're probing the four-point coupling. So this is interesting in the sense that this is the first time that the four-point coupling can be tested. Right? Instead of going, so usually people go to triple heat production test the four-point coupling. But in this case, in DBS, it seems like you're kind of testing.
In electroweakness.
No, don't you think so? I have the impression that you are. But maybe I'm wrong.
You are, but...
We can even prove the trilinear couple of the leads. I mean, indirectly look at DBS.
Of the single disk.
Not even Higgs-6, also just WW, the usual DBS.
WW to Higgs.
These guys. Kind of these guys. I think I didn't know that. But then this is model dependent. So should have nothing else and no electrode.
I think what's
interesting
is that if you have a like vector-positive scattering, if you have a modification,
you can. Yes.
Then you can put down. But there is the Spanish people did a bit more that. They look what did it. Look at the DBS at high energy. What would be the impact on the coupling of the
countries? So, Guti, if you can dig up this paper, then that's something interesting, I think. So, I think the interesting parts for me would be how sound the theoretical framework behind this analysis is. Because I think there's some strange dimension A, and also this thing of testing.
I have the impression that dimension 6 would be enough, because the divergence starts at the second two rules.
Okay. And also the conclusion was a bit pessimistic. Can you put the combined, it seems that we're still measuring at 50%. Even you're measuring the triple Higgs coupling at 50%.
Yeah, in 20 years.
Even after, is that the right way of looking at this? In 20 years, 50%? Oh boy.
Mm-hmm. And there's still people doing it. And then, this is just the Hailumi and just the double Higgs. Then, if you combine with single Higgs, you can.
Your last slide, the conclusion. You say that there is a Higgs coupling before 20 years. And this you are assuming just with the Hailumi, but then you won't know.
No, if you have better analysis techniques, if you have better combination process, and then you can. Because this is a projection, and a projection always takes a second that you have the same analysis techniques that you're using now. You can go better than the projection if you
smart. To go there, you should be able to go below, let's say, 2 sigma. You should should exclude the zero, the lambda, the chi lambda equals zero at least two sigma. That's what your would be your range.
Or five. But exclude the zero, it's one of the big points. Then you say that we can finally say that we have a Higgs. Some point. Because this is becoming like the black hole thing. Everybody knows, everybody knew that was there, but the first direct measurement, it was some couple of years ago only. As you have more data, so you can do smarter higher energies. I was thinking about higher luminosity. In double Higgs, I wouldn't say so. We can relate the different energies and gain something from this relation. Can have how much the cross section increases, or how much the limits itself in the two energies change and infer something from that. So it's always more information. But the secret here is, I think, is more luminosity than the energy. In high lumina. There are projections, but I don't think so.
I think you know after this strategy, what's called particle physics strategy, when it's done, you know. When? It's very soon, because there was this...
Because it seems like this kind of projection should exist for double
beams. Yeah. So the projection should be there.
No, every projection have a double Higgs inside.
I'm going to go to the page of the Granada workshop. Did you go?
Yes,
I don't know. If I go to a workshop, doesn't mean I know the answer to what was everything was said in the workshop.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's thank Alexander again. So,